The greatest day in history.
Greatest day in history.
Death is beaten.
Death is beaten. You have rescued me. Sing it out. Jesus is alive.
The empty cross, the empty grave.
The empty cross, the empty grave. Life eternal, you have won the day. Shout it out. Jesus is alive.
He's alive.
He's alive.
And oh, happy day, happy day.
You wash my sin away. Oh, happy day, happy day. I'll never be the same.
Forever I'm chained.
Forever I'm chained.
When I stand.
When I stand in that place. Free at last, meeting face to face. I'm yours, Jesus, you are mine.
Endless joy and perfect peace.
Endless joy and perfect peace. Earthly pain finally will cease. Celebrate, Jesus is alive.
He's alive.
He's alive.
And oh, happy day, happy day.
You wash my sin away. Oh, happy day, happy day.
I'll never be the same. Oh,
happy day, happy day.
You wash my sin away.
Oh, happy day, happy day.
I'll never be the same. Forever I am changed.
Forever I am changed.
Oh, what a glorious day.
What a glorious day.
What a glorious way.
What a glorious way. That you have saved me.
And oh,
what a glorious day.
What a glorious name.
What a glorious name.
And his name is Jesus.
Jesus.
And oh,
happy day, happy day. You wash my sin away. Oh, happy day, happy day. I'll never be
all
the same.
Happy day,
happy day, happy day. You wash my sin away. Oh, happy day, happy day. I'll never be the same.
I'll never be the same. Forever,
forever I'm changed.
Thank you, Jesus. What can wash away my sin?
Wash away my sin.
Nothing but the blood of Jesus.
What can make me whole again?
Nothing but the blood of Jesus.
What can wash away my sin?
Nothing but the blood of Jesus.
What can make me whole again?
Nothing but the
nothing but the blood of Jesus.
nothing but the blood of Jesus.
For my cleansing, this my plea,
nothing but the blood of Jesus.
This is all my hope and peace,
nothing but the blood. But the blood of Jesus.
Oh, precious.
Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow.
No other.
No
bound. I know nothing but.
Nothing but the blood of Jesus.
Oh, precious.
Oh, precious is the flow. No,
no other, no
other fount I know. Nothing but the blood of Jesus.
Nothing but the blood.
Nothing but the blood. Nothing but the blood.
Nothing but.
Nothing but the blood of Jesus.
Nothing but.
Nothing but the blood. Nothing but the blood. Nothing but the blood.
Nothing but the blood.
Nothing but the blood. Nothing but the blood. Nothing but the blood of Jesus.
Go tell your neighbor it's nothing but the blood.
Nothing but the blood. Nothing but the blood of Jesus.
Is this on? Well, we kept greeting and the music stopped, and you know, I mean, we're all off, but hey, I'm happy to be here this morning. It's good to see you all. It's good to see you all. Bless you. Okay, right on. Yes, everybody, including you, Charles. That's right, that's right. This morning, we don't really have any announcements, so just check your bulletin. There's plenty of stuff going on. And I'd like to call Scott Ford as we prepare this morning with our ushers to receive our offering. And I just encourage you, as you're throughout our worship service, the reason that we have communion up here is so that we're keeping our minds stayed on the reality that we're going to break bread together today. It's a special Sunday. And so be thinking about that. Take that time to really consider the weight and the depth of what we're going to do in sharing in the Lord's Supper together today. So anyways, here's Scott. Good looking man, isn't he? Good guy.
As Yasha's prepared to receive the offering, let's just pray, because there's not a whole lot to say after that. That's awesome. Father, we come before you this morning, Lord Jesus, and we offer ourselves up to you, Lord God, as your sons and daughters. Father, we come before you and we lay down all the things that we hold important in our lives, and we submit to you. And God, we thank you that you have provided every need for us. Maybe sometimes it's not what we think we need, God, but it is what you want for us. So, Father, we ask today as we give our tithes and offerings to you, Lord Jesus, that, Father, you would use them to further the kingdom of God. But that, God, you would put inside of each one of us, Lord, just a desire to serve you completely. Lord, our desire to grow into a deeper, more intimate walk with you would be the thing that we focus on. We'd lay aside all the things that we have planned or ideas that we want. And God, we would just truly spend time with you. We love you this morning, Lord God. We pray as we take communion and as we get into worship and as Pastor Danny brings the word that, Father, this day would be a glorious day. That your presence would visit and move and change lives. And that, Lord, we would become undone and just be exactly what it is that you want it to be. Thank you for this time in your son's name. Amen.
your glory fall as you respond to us. Spirit, rain, flood into our thirsty hearts again. You'll come, let your glory fall as you
of the King. I've been ushered in to your presence. Lord, I stand on your merciful ground, yet with every step tread with reverence.
Welcomed in
to the courts of the King. I've been ushered in to your presence. Lord, I stand on your merciful ground, yet with every step tread with reverence.
I'll fall face down.
Your glory shines around.
I'll fall face down.
And I'll fall face down.
As your glory shines around.
Who is there?
Who is there in the heavens like you, and upon the earth who's your equal? You are far above, you're the highest of heights, and we are bowing down to exalt you.
And I'll fall face down.
And I'll fall face down as your glory shines around.
I'll fall face down.
And I'll fall face down as your glory shines around.
I'll fall face down.
And I'll fall face down as your glory shines around.
Yes, I'll
face down as your glory shines around. Shines around. Lord, let your glory. So let your glory shine around. Let your glory shine around. King of glory, here be found. King of glory. So let your glory shine around. Let your glory shine around. King of glory, here be found. King of glory. Your glory shine around, Lord. Be glorified in this place. And a full face down. And a full. Yes, a full face down as your glory shines around. A full face down, God, a full face down as your glory shines around. Yes, a full. Your glory shines around. Shine around.
Holy, 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 Lord.
with your glory.
Sing Hosanna. Hosanna, 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 Hosanna,
Jesus. Just want to invite you to stay in this atmosphere of worship and really, as best as you can, not pay attention to me, but really pay attention to the Spirit of God that is drawing us deeper in this moment. And I know for us in a room like this that a lot of us are coming from a different place, different experiences in God, and maybe you're even a visitor with us today, and just want to point you to Jesus right now. Just want to point you to the Holy Spirit of God who longs to draw you deeper. And as I was worshiping, I was thinking through the next steps of our service and thinking through the sermon in my mind, and in my mind I really saw us receiving communion as an application to the things I wanted to share, and it came so strong to me that we need to do this now here in our worship time. It's almost like when Jesus did that miracle when he changed the water into wine, you know, and they were amazed that the good stuff was coming first, and I felt like the Lord just wanted to touch you. He wanted to touch us as a body with his grace and his goodness. And I've been talking about peace. I've been talking about the peace of God. And I'll just kind of cut to the punchline of the sermon, and I believe we'll get to the sermon, but the thing that robs our peace, the way that we're not able to access the peace of God, is when our relationship is broken somehow. And it's the same in our human relationships, isn't it? Husbands and wives, when there's friction in home, some peace goes away, right? That's why they say, happy wife, happy life. You know, it's kind of, and it goes both ways in that. But it's in the same in our relationship with God. And I'm going to show you in Scripture, James gives a picture of that purity and peace are linked together. And I don't know about you, but my efforts to be pure on my own, my efforts to be righteous on my own really leave me tired and empty. But when we come to the table of communion, we're reminded that it's Jesus' righteousness that touches your life. It's Jesus. It's for those tears he died. It's for those sins that he died, the ones that you and I have committed, past, present, and future. And I felt as though we needed to receive communion like real soon. And when we do, that we understand what we're doing. And I know that for those of us that have been raised in the church, I know our youth, you know, you've been to 1,001 church services. And if you're a little older than youth, you maybe have been to 50,001 church services. And so there's always a temptation to maybe not receive this in a worthy manner, the manner worthy that Jesus intended for us to receive it in. And see, I feel for us, our congregation, our church, that God wants to manifest his peace into your life. He wants to give you his peace in your relationships. He wants to give you peace with him so that what you could be peacemakers for others. Because as we said last week, you can't give away what you don't have. It just doesn't work. And so communion this morning is about God's peace. And God's peace comes when you're reconciled to him. He, Jesus, is our peace, reconciling us to the Father, breaking down every dividing wall. And as I read this, I just want to share with you one little point, and then I want to invite Ben to lead us back into worship. I want to invite you to take some time and sit with the Lord. Don't be in a hurry this morning, right? We've got time. It's early in our service. We've got time to sit with God and not miss a moment, an opportunity for the Spirit of God to touch maybe a certain area in your life and say, I want that. I want to free you from the guilt of that particular sin. I want to free you. And how does that come? It comes by way of our confession and our repentance, and then freedom comes, and with freedom comes peace. God wants to do it. And sometimes things get brushed so far under the rug that we don't even want to lift the rug up that far to go back. But guess what? It's still there. And unconfessed sin needs to be dealt with in my life, in your life. And if we've hidden those things before God, they're not hidden at all. He wants to open them up. Not because he's mean, not because he wants to embarrass you, not because of any of those reasons. He's a father who wants to free you. And what father wouldn't want to see their children free? What father, when their child asks for a piece of bread, is going to give them a snake? And how much more, or a stone, how much more our Heavenly Father wants to give you today, right now, good things, namely his peace. And listen to what I read here this morning. And this is from Corinthians, 1 Corinthians chapter 11. For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and he gave thanks, and he broke it. This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And we're about to do that. He says, in the same way, after the supper, he took the cup. This is the new covenant of my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. And hear this. Okay, listen to this part. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Why is that important? Why is it important that Jesus died? For your sins. He became the sacrifice for everything we've ever committed. And so every time we do this, we are proclaiming, we're declaring that it's not our righteousness that gives us right standing before God. It's not our own efforts that give us peace with God. It's what Jesus did. And this morning, I want to invite you to proclaim his death. Who are you proclaiming it to? As David said, break forth unto joy, O my soul. Sometimes you need to remind yourself that Jesus died for your sins. But guess who else wants to remind you and accuse you day and night? That's where your peace goes. That's where it's robbed, is when the joy stealer, the peace stealer, steals from you that joy and peace that you have in Christ by reminding you and blackmailing you. And see, when you come to the table and you proclaim his death, you basically hold the trump card and you say, listen, Jesus died for that. I proclaim his death until he returns. And when he returns, right on. Right on. When he returns, no more tears, no more suffering, no more sorrow, no more striving. We'll be known as we're meant to be known. And so I'm going to invite Ben to lead us in a song of worship, but I really want you to think specifically about what we do this morning when we receive communion. This morning, as individuals in your own life, between you and God, very personal thing today. Although it's very personal, we do it together because we're meant to be in fellowship with one another. But what do you need to proclaim his death over in your life? What needs to be held over in your life to say, oh, no, Jesus died for that. And if we say that there's any one thing that he couldn't have died for, some sin that's so heinous that he couldn't have died for it, then we minimize the sacrifice that Jesus made on the cross. His blood is enough. His blood is enough, and it covers over all unrighteousness. Let's sing again. Ben, lead us, and as he does, prepare your heart. Listen to the Lord. Don't miss this opportunity. Maybe you don't have a relationship with God. This could be your first time of breaking bread. The Bible says that this is a thing Christians do. It's not some exclusive club that only we get to do this ceremony. But it makes no sense if you don't know the Lord, if you don't honor what he's done in your life, that you would be declaring his death or proclaiming it over your life. It has to be received. And so if you're wanting Jesus' death on the cross to cover your sins, you want to confess him as the Lord of your life, you want to invite him in, what a great way to do it here at the table of communion. If you don't, that's okay. This is a sacred thing between you and God. No one here will judge you for it. No one will. It's his kindness that draws you into repentance. And so just think about these things, and let's just obey scripture today. Let's declare and proclaim his death over our lives. Amen. If you lead us.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost,
'Twas grace.
'Twas grace that taught my heart to
continues to play music, would you to just begin to allow the Holy Spirit to speak to you? Just get that time with God. What is he touching on? Is it an attitude? Is it a relationship? Is it something that you need to confess before him? If you confess your sin, he's faithful and just to cleanse you from all unrighteousness. God, those things of the flesh that we are plagued with, God, as they come to the surface, we thank you that that's why you died. God, we confess these things before you, all the junk of the flesh. Lord, as it's risen up this week, as it maybe rose up today, as it rose up several months ago, or whatever it is that we're trying to manage on our own, God, we just choose to expose it and say, here we go, take it, God. So sorry. We can't manage our life, God. We need you. The peace that God gives is not peace at any price that just makes us feel better. It's a very costly peace. It cost him everything. everything, and it costs us confession. It costs us exposure, and we expose it to Him and let Him come and forgive us. And in that way, we proclaim His death until He comes again. He is our sacrifice. You alone, Jesus. You alone, God. You alone. Praise You. As you're ready, and Jesus, I see it in Scripture, and He invites us to come. He says, whosoever would come. That's why I love, it's okay when we pass out communion to you as a way to serve you, but I love that you would come. That when you're ready, you come to the table and you take those elements in your hands. And if you're not able to walk up here this morning for whatever reason, that's okay too. But as you come up here, would you grab the elements in your hands and just stay here. Maybe you can fan out across the front as we receive together. But even when He comes to the church, what does He do? He knocks on the door waiting for us to open to Him. So if you're ready to come, come and just receive communion this morning, and we'll break bread and pray together. Continue to be served. Let's just sing this chorus together. Amazing Grace. Imagine for how many years believers have gathered, over hundreds of years. This song was written, I think, in the 1700s. And so this chorus has been sung as people have gathered and just relished in the grace of God and said, wow, that His grace is really that good. Let's declare the grace of God before we break bread. Go ahead and lead us.
Amazing Grace. How sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see.
Symbol of His body that was broken for you. Would you remind yourself of what Jesus did? It isn't just for Easter time that we think about it, but daily as believers, we live in the reality that we are crucified with Christ. It's no longer us who lives, but Christ who lives in us. And the life that we live now, we live by faith in the Son of God who loved us and He gave Himself for us. And God, as we hold this up before You, we hold it up in a way of declaring and proclaiming Your death. You died for our sins. You became the sacrifice because we couldn't manage sin on our own. You're the perfect Lamb, the Lamb that was slain, what was prophesied even before the New Testament came, that you would be, Jesus, that perfect and spotless and blameless Lamb. And so, Lord, now here as we hold this before you, God, we confess our sins. Lord, we confess that we've wronged you, God. We've confessed that we've broken your heart. Jesus. But God, I thank you that that's not the end of the story. Lord, that you don't hold us and keep us in that spot of hopelessness, but you make it so clear that in our weakness, you can become strong if we'll let you. And so, God, now we do. We confess our sin before you. And we thank you for the sacrifice that you made for us on the cross over 2,000 years ago. It's for us today. And we receive it in the name of Jesus. Amen. Says of the cup that it's a symbol of the new covenant in blood. God's grace poured out upon us. We know the scripture that without the shedding of blood, there could be no remission of sin. And God, we thank you for your grace, and don't we need it? God, we receive it this morning. Lord, we thank you for your power in us, God. The blood of Jesus, there's life in the blood. And it's your life that we desire and ask, God. Would you fill us afresh and anew with your Spirit, God? Would you fill us afresh and anew, Lord, with the power to live a pure and a holy life before you? And Jesus, this morning we receive that newness of life. And as you drink today, let this be a cleansing drink for you. The blood of Jesus washing over you and cleansing you from all unrighteousness. Though your sins be as scarlet, they'll be white as snow. As far as the east is from the west, that's how far he removes our transgressions from us, to be remembered no more. That's what his word says. Let's just drink this together. Before you go back to your seats, just soak the moment in. Would you just stay where you're at, and we sing one more song of worship. James chapter 5 talks about our worship gatherings, and it says, is anyone happy? Let them sing songs of praise. Is anyone sick? Let them call on the elders of the church. It gives this picture of all of us in different places, and we bring ourselves fully to God. And this morning, if you're happy, would you just sing songs of praise? If you are in need of a touch from God, would you open your heart to him to bring healing? Communion has a healing element to it, because it was because of his stripes and what he endured on the cross that we can be healed. If you need a fresh touch from God's Spirit, just open your heart to him as we sing this song. Let communion not be just a physical act, but a spiritual one for you this morning.
My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior, has ransomed me. And like a flood, his mercy rains, unending love, amazing.
My chains are gone.
My chains are gone.
Amazing. unending love,
unending love, amazing grace.
You know, as a way of just agreeing with God in an act of warfare, would you just clap and shout to God for the victory over your life? Thank you, God. Thank you. I know we already greeted, but since you're already next to each other, you might as well give one more hug to each other. And I mean, just one hug. That was the whole deal. It was a very specific. You know, as you're all being seated, the special day today for a number of reasons, but I just want to acknowledge Justin up there who graduated from college with his bachelor's degree yesterday. Well done. We have a birthday today, Dijon, our bass player. And I'm sure there's like a handful of other things. Anybody else graduate or do anything that... Well, hey, bless you if you did, and Brina, happy birthday to you. I know you had a birthday this week. It's a great day to be together, you know, and I just believe that God is doing something special in each one of our lives, and I believe that any time frame, he has something specific, and I do think that this message of peace is for us today. And how many of you know, and Peggy said it so well in the midst of a crisis that she and her family went through, that you don't start preparing for crisis when you're in the middle of it, but you're prepared for crisis as a believer. Isn't that true? And how are you prepared for crisis? You're prepared for it by storing up and hiding the word in your heart, by the fellowship. The reason that we do this, that we encourage one another in the Lord week after week, is to keep each other spurred on in the faith, because crisis comes, things happen. And Jacob, if you kind of want to make your way up here, a couple of weeks ago now, I got a phone call, and some of you know Jacob and Renee, but they were in a terrible accident. And it was one of those situations where I was really nervous, and I had heard that he was T-boned, and they took him to ICU for trauma, but it was one of those hospital visits where you go wanting to encourage somebody, and here is Jacob just barely hanging on, having a broken hip and possibly internal bleeding, and he's just like blessing everybody in the area. I'm sorry, I'm going to brag about you a little bit, but telling the nurses what a great job that they do and how much he appreciates the care that they were giving, and just being a witness for Christ in the middle of it all. I just was blown away. And we sat in that area there and read scripture, but you could just feel the presence of God and what I would call literally the force of God's peace in a really just tense environment. If you know, the emergency room alone is a tense environment, but a trauma area is very tense. And yet God's presence, because he inhabits the praises of his people. And so when Jacob asked me if he could share a little testimony, I was like, well, I'll see if we've got time on Sunday, you know, and stuff like that. So, but anyways, bro, whatever you want to say, you're welcome to say it. And I know many of you have been praying. And so anyways, whatever you want to say, rock on.
Well, Dan said most of it, basically.
sorry.
That's all right. You know, I was T-boned. There's a Toyota Celica that's actually served three people in this church. It's been communicating with God for a long time. And I'm sorry to say that it is finally destroyed. Sorry. Former owners of the Toyota Celica. On a real natural perspective, you know, I was, or analytical overview of it, I was T-boned by a lady just going 50, didn't brake, didn't swerve, nothing, you know, hit the driver's side. In hospital for 3 weeks, 2 weeks of just basically being immobile, staring at the ceiling, and a broken hip. But I really think I don't have like a natural perspective on things. Ten years ago, the Lord, I had been really wrestling with the Lord in prayer about blessing my life and bringing me a wife and a career and all these things. And the Lord told me very clearly that 10 years from now, I will. All your hopes and dreams I'll bring to like fruition. And the injury I received, I didn't have a bump or a scratch or a cut or even a bruise. The only thing was a major trauma between my acetabulum and the head of my femur, which is the exact injury Jacob received in the Bible. You know, he went through a big transformation in his life. And it's not that I think that the Lord caused the accident, but it was so clear that he's in absolute control of all terrible circumstances and that he brings about glory for himself and a completion of like prophetic words he's given in the past, you know? You know, that was a wonderful like kind of thumbprint of God on the situation. And mostly why I wanted to come up here to talk about was I was literally conscious of people praying for me. So many people were praying for me. The Brammers were there in like 10 minutes of the accident praying for me. Christian got on the internet and got on all these prayer ministries and had them praying for me. I was very conscious of people praying for me, and the peace of God descended on me in the hospital. I was staring at the ceiling for 2 weeks, you know, basically in the 3 weeks total, and the peace and joy of the Lord for 2 weeks straight, I was so happy and had so much peace and knew that God was like totally there. And I just want to thank everyone so much. I was very overwhelmed with the amount of like prayer I received, and I want to say it's so, so powerful, like, walking along side with the Lord, because he was going to bless me regardless, but having the prayers of the saints again, which I was so conscious of, and like Danny mentioned, that overwhelming sense of peace and hope that I had in the hospital was like, it was to a point where I was able to, like, you know, bless and minister the people around me, even the point where relatives of mine who weren't even really believers would be prompted to prayer and then get words of knowledge for me and call me in the hospital and confirm the same thing the Lord was touching me. So as you guys prayed for me, it was felt like a lightning rod, and it just was shooting out to members of my family. So prayer, when the church comes together in prayer and agrees for one thing, like, you know, me in the situation, which I'm so humbled that you guys would do that, it's so powerful on so many levels. I was got great, you know, service and healing, and the surgery went really well. I mean, my family members were touched, and then so many levels the kingdom of God was pushed forward. And I'm so grateful to the Lord, and I'm so grateful to the church for coming together and praying for me, and so much peace and hope. And as if you guys continue to pray for me, there's still like all kinds of hospital bills and lawyer stuff, and like healing needs to take place and all that kind of stuff. From the beginning, I felt the Lord clearly said, I have everything covered, and you're in totally good hands. I'm not worried at all. If you continue to pray, you could pray along those lines. But I wanted to thank the church so much for caring for me so much and for agreeing in prayer and making... it's like a broken hip, like, worth being touched, you know, by God and being met by God and getting these blessings and these transformations. Like, totally is. You know, it's like, it's not, I don't know if I would have done anything different just to see the support of the church and the power of God. I'm so happy about my circumstances. I'm so happy about being broken. I learned so much about how God gives us, when we're wounded and broken, how much the Lord pays the dividends for being broken. He's, you know, as my friends came in and they tried to give me, like, you know, flowers or words of comfort or whatever, how much more does the Lord give us, you know, when we're sitting there broken? And I'm just so grateful even to be broken, and so grateful for you guys' prayers, and I love the church very much, and I wanted to thank you.
Thank you, Jake. Thank you, Jenny. I'm praying for you now. I'm not going to add anything to that, but I do want to take the time to pray. Scott, would you come? And anyone else who feels led, he mentioned there are some areas of specifics that we could pray, but we're together right now. It would be foolish for us not to just join our hearts together in prayer. And Scott, I'd just give it over to you if you would lead us. And if you wouldn't mind if you would just extend your hand, or if you feel led to come up and lay hands, you're welcome to do it. But let's just pray for Jacob and Renee, both his wife.
God, you are Lord over every situation.
Yes, you are.
And Father, even as Jacob spoke, Lord God, what a testimony, Lord Jesus, of who you are.
Yes, Lord.
And Father, I pray not only for him today, but those that are listening to his words. Yes, and Father, the faith that he has proclaimed and the reality of who God is in his life, And Father, to see, Lord Jesus, his response to this circumstance. God, it builds my faith. But God, now, today, right now, we come before your throne room of grace. And Father, we ask for healing for Jacob in the name of Jesus Christ. And Father, just as we took communion, when we did that, Father, it says very clearly in Isaiah that, Lord, you took our sicknesses and our diseases and you healed our bodies. And so, Father, we proclaim healing over Jacob's body in the name of Jesus. God, that you would restore that hip, Lord God, that you would continue to heal him, Lord Jesus, that, Father, that you would begin to move in the circumstances that are surrounding the accident, that, God, you bring about the end that you want. Lord, he would have favor in every circumstance, the finances, the car, the situations, everything, Lord God. But that, Father, as he has already done, every step of the way, your name would be glorified. And, Father, we thank you for the testimony that they bring. We thank you for them, Lord Jesus. Just cover them both. Cover them with your Holy Spirit. Renew them, Lord Jesus. Empower them to continue to be the servants of Christ that you want them to be. And Father, we honor you today. We give you praise and glory. And we come against the enemy right now in the name of Jesus, who would speak lies, who would speak deceits to them at difficult times or moments. And we ask, Lord God, that they would rely and trust and lean upon your word. And Father, we thank you for it. Bless them today, we pray, in your son's precious name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Thank you, guys. Thank you, Jacob. Thank you very much. That's kind of a living sermon for you. You know it? The peace of God that we've been talking about is not the absence of something. Like we said, it's not what John Lennon thought when he wrote the song Imagine. It's not no more war, no more car accidents, no more fighting and family issues and whatever else. The peace of God is literally the substance of God. It's the presence of God that comes in and overwhelms all that other stuff. Because as it says, the Apostle Paul said it so well in Galatians, that we live in this age of tension, right? This tension where the kingdom comes, but also this flesh rises up and it creates such a tension. And how do we live in tension? We live according to the peace of God. And I wanted to just share, I have 6 pages, okay? But I'm just going to share with you 1. And I'm going to get to the last bit because I believe there's a practical takeaway. Because if I just talk to you about peace and if you hear Jacob's testimony about peace, and I'm not foolish, I know that many of you experience the peace of God all the time. But how do you access it? It's so good. How do you access it? And I want to just give you a little bit of what James said about God's peace. And then we're going to have a time to pray together and then we're going to be on with the rest of our days today. But the first thing that I wanted to take you to is James chapter 3, verse 17. We talked about this last week, James 3, 17. And this is what it says. It says, but the wisdom that comes from heaven is first of all pure. And then it is peace-loving, considerate, submissive, full of mercy and good fruit, impartial and sincere. In verse 18, peacemakers who sow in peace raise a harvest of righteousness. And if you jump down, just follow your page down to chapter 4 and verse 7, I think this is probably it's one of the most practical verses in Scripture. And I love that about James, practical. That's why we named our son, one of the reasons, his middle name is James. You know, Daniel on the prophetic side and James on the practical side. James says to the church words like this, verse 7 of chapter 4. Submit yourselves then to God. Resist the devil and he will flee from you. Come near to God and he will come near to you. And then he says, wash your hands, you sinners, and purify your heart, you double-minded. You know, by the way, James wasn't yelling at you when he said that, you know? We read Scripture through a tone. And maybe we picture James like the guy on the street, wash your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. You know what I'm saying by the raising of the sign and telling you that? He's just saying what is. We've all sinned and fallen short of God's glory. And whenever we're trying to manage our lives, whenever we have broken relationship, whether it's broken relationship with God for any number of reasons, or broken relationship with his people or a person in our life, what do you experience? You experience the absence of peace. You experience tension. And what James is saying is that you've got to work that stuff out. And when you're double-minded, what does he say? A double-minded person is unstable in all that they do. Isn't it amazing that one relationship over here affects everything around here? Isn't that amazing? One fragmented relationship that is over here affects everything that we do around here. How much more so our relationship with God? When our relationship with God isn't where it's supposed to be, it affects everything in our lives. It robs us of our peace. And sometimes peace, or the lack thereof, can be like a thermometer in our lives. Whenever you don't have that peace, whenever you sense that being taken away from you, it's time that we hit our knees and go, okay, what's going on? What's happening here that I don't have peace? That's what I do. When I'm unsettled about something, man, I want to hunt it down and figure out why I'm unsettled. Is it something I said? So many times when I go back to the Lord and I don't have peace, I'll leave a church service on Sunday or a time of interacting with all of you or with other people, and something will just like sit in my gut. And first I have to go through a process and go, okay, is this the devil just ripping me off? Because he sure loves to do that, right? Just mock and, you know, and remind you of how foolish you are or whatever. So I'll go through that process. And if that's not the case, I'll ask the Lord something specific. Did I do, is something not right here? And inevitably, there'll be an interaction that I had with somebody where I might have said a flippant comment, trying to be funny, or said something that maybe came off stern or harsh when that wasn't my heart. But I'll replay that. And maybe some of you have gotten that phone call. Hey, I just wanted to tell you, I'm so sorry that blah, blah, blah. I'm doing that for selfish reasons. I want to be right with you, but I want the peace of God in my life because I want to continue on. You see what I'm saying? And so many times we do that with one another and they'll say, oh, don't worry about it. I didn't think anything of it. Well, for some reason, I did, and the Spirit of God did. And so that's the way that we revisit those relationships and we bring back that connection that we need so that we can have peace. And it's the same with our relationship with God. That's why communion was so important this morning. That whenever we lack peace, we've got to come to the table and say, God, please, whatever it is, forgive me. But it's not wise for us just to throw out the blanket generality, but to sit in the presence of God and say, is there something you're trying to say to me? Because God sure loves to communicate to his people. He sure loves to talk to you. He sure loves to be specific with you if you'll let him, because he wants us to grow and grow in grace. And so that's what that is all about. But when we look at that James chapter 4, just real quick here, there's three things that I believe will pull peace from you or keep you from the peace of God. And the first one is lack of submission to the will of God. Lack of submission to the will of God. And what does that mean? If Jesus is the Prince of Peace and you're not submitted to him, then what will you have? You won't have peace. He is the Prince of Peace. And so you have to look at areas in your life. Am I walking outside of God's will? Am I walking away from him? Am I doing things that I shouldn't do? And when you come to that place of realization, you get it right. The second thing that I think robs us of peace is demonic attack. And I believe that there is a literal demonic attack. Sometimes we just want to rationalize that away because it's just so weird and kooky or whatever. And you think, well, people are even wacko if I'm talking about that. You can think that, but it's a reality that evil oppresses people, that the enemy seeks to devour you. And I believe that this devouring and that this oppression that he wants to bring is a very legal situation. In other words, it only can function where doors are left open. It's amazing to me that when I talk with people and say, for example, they're experiencing anxiety or fear or just overwhelmed with this like dark thoughts and whatever, and we begin to sort of peel the onion. Many times we find that there are doors that were left open. For example, this might sound silly, but for the one that's in fear all the time and we begin to say, well, what kind of stuff do you watch on TV? Oh, I love horror films. I can't get enough of them. You know, I love the anxiety that, you know, freaking myself out and whatever. And sometimes like that's how subtle and how simple it can be. And when you expose something like that, so in other words, whatever you're opening your eyes to, whatever comes in this gate affects this heart. Whatever comes in this gate affects the entire heart. And so if you're experiencing some of the enemy's attack in your life, there's a reason that a certain door has been opened. And that's, again, the need to sit before God and to ask the presence of God to overwhelm you, but as well to be proactive. Because your search for peace, your quest for peace of God, for the sowing into peace is proactive. It's not passive. You don't sort of wait, sit back and go, okay, peace come. Yes, there is this reality of the Holy Spirit overwhelming you, but go after it. Go after it. And here's one of the ways that you do it, that you get into God's presence. Because when he says in James, draw near to God and he'll draw near to you, what does the opposite mean? Resist God and he pulls away from you. It's about relationship. Everything in our walk is about relationship with God. And so if you're distanced from the presence of God, get close to the presence of God. How do you do that? I got some ways. I'm going to throw them at you right now. One, submit to him. Two, spend regular and frequent times in worship. regular and frequent times in worship. Why do we sing so much at Zion? Worship. It cultivates an environment for the Spirit of God to come and to touch our lives, to let the peace of God come. And I would invite you and I would encourage you, take advantage of it. We're going to do it anyway, so you might as well take full advantage of what's happening. You might say, well, I'm not a singer. That's okay. It's perfectly fine and all right for you just to prayerfully just sit in the presence of God and soak it in and use your mind, though. Don't check out. You know, don't come to the 11:30 service. You know what I'm saying? Sit there and think about the wonder of God. Think about the character of God. And you might grow in this. You might find that you start singing and you don't even know why you're singing. And you don't have to worry if you don't sing good, because as we said, and you've heard probably your many other places, it's about a joyful noise, not about a peaceful harmony. God doesn't care what you sound like. Just let it out. But if you're not ready to let it out, at least engage in your mind. And in that time, enjoy the presence of God, but be active in it and think and call to mind who God is and consider the words that are being sung. Man, I don't know about you, but sometimes it's just the right song that speaks of the character of God. It's not the melody. It's not the one who wrote the song. It's the declaration of who he is that raises something up inside of me, and I just come alive. I can come to a church service down. I can come heavy, but as I engage in worship, as I get close to the presence of God, peace overwhelms me. Joy overwhelms me. The fruit of God's Spirit is there. That's why we do it. And so don't just wait for Sunday morning for that, but pay attention to your own personal worship time. There's so many ways that you can worship God. You don't have to just sing songs, although that's a great way. You can listen to worship music. You can pray in the Spirit. You can spend time meditating on God's Word. You can go for a walk with the Lord. What a cool thing to do. Just can you imagine how much it pleases God to walk with him? Just to go for a walk and just say, God, whatever, I just want to be with you. And open your eyes to the surroundings. Open your eyes to the beauty that's all around you and say, God, speak to my heart and let him do that. But it requires us to be active in that. And so spend time, frequent time in worship. There's a story in 1 Samuel. We won't go into it, but what you probably already know it. 1 Samuel chapter 16. Do you remember Saul? Saul is a great case study for somebody who had the peace of God and the peace of God went away. And why did it go away? Disobedience. He had a broken relationship with God and a broken relationship with others. The two are so important. The whole thing, it's not just about you and God. It's about you and God and you and others. It's all throughout Scripture. And when Saul had a fragment or a broken relationship with God, when he disobeyed God, and when he disobeyed the priest, the presence of God was lifted from him, and he was oppressed by an evil spirit. And what did he do? He needed somebody to come to bring worship to him, to bring soothing music. And so David, the harp player, came and played the harp and learned how to dodge arrows. You know, if you want to look at it, it's in 1 Samuel chapter 16. But I'm trying to tell you, these aren't just my ideas or my thoughts about why we do or don't have peace. It's in the Word of God. When we're distant from God, when we have a broken relationship with others or God, peace is lifted. And the only way to get back to that peace is to reconcile with God. But the good news and the takeaway is Jesus becomes our peace and he becomes our reconciler. The last thing, and this is just buzzing through these points, is that we need to live, think, and store the Word of God in our heart. So we live, we think, and we store the Word of God in our heart. You know, I'm so tempted to make jokes today about yesterday being the 21st. And, you know, I was so tempted to start the service by saying I didn't plan a sermon because I didn't think we were going to be here. You know, all that kind of stuff. But if you don't know what I'm talking about, there was it was all over the news that we were supposed to be raptured yesterday. And as funny as that is to make a joke about it, how sad it is that there are many people who are just devastated today. Many people who are completely disillusioned going, well, I gave all my stuff away and I wasn't supposed to be here. And, you know, and some people are making jokes saying, hey, if you really believe that's going to happen, sign your bank account over to me and I'll have your money while you're gone. I mean, but see, we joke about that. But what about the people who don't think, believe, and live the Word of God in their life? You talk about a lack of peace. You talk about a disillusionment having to recover from the leader that they thought had all the answers. And yet, 6 o'clock rolled around or whenever it was and they didn't go, you know what I mean? So for you, I don't know if you experienced any anxiety or if you had a second thought about it. I'm not trying to be boastful, but one thing I did when I heard that news, I guaranteed that I was making plans for Saturday evening. Why? Because no matter how you try to bend that scripture and try to make it in Matthew chapter 24, when Jesus says no man will know the day or the hour, it means no one's going to know the day or the hour. I've even read people trying to figure out, well, it didn't really mean that. It means this. I said, no, it means that. And it's reinforced when it says that the day will come like a thief in the night. What does a thief in the night come like? Do you expect the thief? Well, if you live in certain neighborhoods, maybe you do. But the point there was, you don't expect the thief to come, but you're always prepared. You're foolish if you just leave your windows and your doors open and, you know, all your stuff visible. So what Jesus was trying to convey through parables and what was written in Thessalonians was the understanding that he's coming and we need to live in constant anticipation that he can come any minute. That's what motivates us. That's the reality of his imminent return. It was in Paul's message. It was in the true message of the gospel has that written into it. We live in that. But we're not going to know the day or the hour. That's not the point. And so I use that as an illustration to say, if we know God's word, if we live God's word, if we hide his word in our heart, stuff like that just kind of rolls off our shoulders. We're not going to make foolish decisions based on one man's assumption of scripture or his emphatic understanding that this is when it's going to happen. It's amazing to me. But you know what? It shouldn't be, because weren't there those that infiltrated the church in the New Testament that preached a different gospel? And won't they continue to do that now? And how will we know the real from the counterfeit? By spending time with the real, by spending time in the presence of God, by taking in the word of God and letting it become a light and a lamp to us. Psalm 119 says, I've hidden your word in my heart that I might not sin against you. Hiding the word in God in your heart. How do you do that? Well, to me, what is the word? What is the living word? John chapter 1:14. The word became flesh and dwelt among us and made his home here. He is the word. Can I tell you something? You don't worship a book. You don't worship a Bible. And that's important for nowadays, because so many of you don't have a book anymore. It's on a phone or an iPad or whatever else. And so if we were worshiping a book, we'd have to give up. We don't worship the words on the page. We worship the living God that's expressed through all the books of this Bible. The living word. And we hide the living word in our heart, and he's in us. And we know him more by what we read of him. And it's not just the words, because believe it or not, that there are people who go to seminary who are experts in this book that are atheists. Let me say that again. There are people who know this book better than you, better than me. And they're atheists. They don't believe in God at all. They've made it an academic pursuit to understand the history of this, who wrote it, when they wrote it, why it was written, what it meant to the original audience, and so forth. And that's what they do. And for them, this word has not taken hold or root, because they're worshiping a book and the words on the pages. They're taking it in a carnal way. We worship the living God who is revealed through Scripture. It is about revelation. When we read it, it's the aha moment that comes. It's what happened to me today when I was thinking about communion, and I flipped to 1 Corinthians chapter 11, and I read that line that said that we proclaim his death until he returns, and the light went on in my mind and say, we need today to proclaim the death of Jesus over our lives and realize the sacrifice that he made. That was a revelation from God, and it happens to us all the time if we'll hide his word in our heart. And when we hide his word, I remember as a kid, I went to a Christian school, and every day we pledged to the flag, we pledged to the Christian flag, and we pledged to the Bible. And we said that, I will hide his word in my heart that I might not sin against God. Every day we said that. How sad that, oh, never mind, I won't even go on there. That's a total tangent. Okay. I told you I'd give you one page, and I've just given you two. So let me stop for today. But when we understand the word of God, and when we take it in our hearts, when we take the fullness of God's word, when we get near the presence of God, and when we reconcile our relationship with God and others, the benefit, the result is peace. If you don't have peace, whether it's a small lack of peace, don't push that feeling under the rug. Expose it. Turn the lights on to it. Say, okay, what's going on? Because you need his peace. And it's not just for your personal benefit. It's not just for your own edification. Why? It's for you to give away. Peacemakers, blessed are the what? Peacemakers, because they're just like their dad. They're just like God. That's what the Beatitude says. And I'll say when I was with Jacob in the hospital, it was a perfect example. When I was with Renee, it was a perfect example of that. God's word hidden in their heart. A biblical worldview, understanding that bad stuff happens to good people. So why say, why me, and whatever else? Will those emotions come? Yes, but when the word is hidden, you're able to deal with that. And then there you are, laying in a hospital bed, speaking peace, causing peace, changing the environment. That's the kingdom of God. And that's what he wants for each one of us. That's what he wants, not only in these four walls, but he wants that in your homes. He wants that in your homes, that you don't have to be perfect people, but when there is imperfection that comes in, that you settle a matter so that when others come to borrow a cup of sugar or whatever they're going to come over to do, like we live in a country, whatever. But anyways, whenever they come to your house, that they just go, I came through your gate and I walked in your door and there's a force of peace, not the absence of something, but the presence of God is here. It's worth it. And God wants it. He wants it for you, and he wants it for our church. So why don't we stand together? And Ben, I don't know if you could come and lead us in a closing song. That would be great if you could. I want to pray for you today, and I want to come back to our communion. And I want to come back to the idea that with purity, James connects purity with peace. And you can be pure through the blood of Jesus. You can be pure through the confession of sin. You can be pure through what Jesus has done. And here's what Paul says. It's one of my favorite verses. In Philippians chapter 4, rejoice in the Lord always, and I will say it again, and rejoice. And what does always mean, by the way?
Always.
Yeah, the Greek, always. It's amazing. Rejoice in the Lord always, and I will say it again, rejoice. You can only rejoice in a situation like a tragedy when you have his word hidden and stored in your heart, because you've got a bigger vision. Your vision isn't like this, it's eternal. And so rejoice in the Lord always, I will say it again. And then he goes on, let your gentleness be evident to all. The Lord is near. Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything, with prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Let's pray and sing this song. Well, first let's sing a song, then pray.
The perfect application of that is let's surrender all.
All to Jesus I surrender. All to him I free.
Surrender all.
I surrender all. I surrender all. All to thee, my blessed Savior, I surrender.
God, I pray this week, even today, Lord, that you would reconcile relationships. That God, you would do a work in each of our hearts, that at minimum we would decide that as much as it depends upon us, that we would live at peace with the person that isn't at peace with us. Lord, I pray that you would reconcile relationship between people and you. God, those that are distant from you this morning, that they would feel drawn by your grace today. And that, Lord, you would wash over whatever it is that keeps them far from you. And as they draw near to you, God, I pray you would draw near to them. As we frequently experience your presence, as we often go to you in worship, not just on Sunday morning and Wednesday night, but often we walk with you and we talk with you and we sing to you and we read your word and we hide it in our heart. And Lord, I pray that peace would overwhelm your people, so much so that they would, by nature of just who they are, be peacemakers. And God, I pray as well, Lord, that we would think biblically, that we would live biblically, that we would act that way, God. Lord, let your word be hidden in our heart. And I thank you for it today in the name of Jesus. Bless your people, God. Pour out over them your perfect peace, I pray today, in your precious name, amen. Hey, before you leave, I had forgotten. I wanted to pray for Josh. Josh got selected to go to space camp in Texas. And so if you just come up after, and whoever wants to come and pray, he's going to be leaving this week. And he was chosen special from a lot of students in his school to go and spend a week there. And so we want to pray for you as you head out. But God bless all of you, and have an awesome week.